The date of the interview is November 17, 1995. The survivor is Edith Honig. Her last name at birth was Heilig. The interviewer is Mary Ziegler. The city is Sydney, New South Wales, country Australia, and the language is English.
It's Friday, the 17th of November 1995, and my name is Mary Ziegler, Z-I-E-G-L-E-R, and I'm interviewing Edith Honig in Sydney, Australia. Dieter, can I call you Dieter?
Yes, by all means.
Let's begin with the formal part of the interview. Can you tell me your name and how to spell it?
Edith Honig, H-O-E-N-I-G.
And your name at birth?
Edith. And to spell?
No, the birth, at birth, your maiden name.
Heilig, H-E-I-L-I-G.
And any other names or nicknames?
Dieter.
Your birth date?
4th of May 1926.
So how old are you now?
69.
Now the city you were born in?
Prostějov.
How do you spell that?
P-R-O-S-T-E-V-O-V.
And the country?
Czechoslovakia.
Okay, thank you. Prostějov, can you tell me where that is?
It's Moravia, the middle of Moravia.
Near what city would it be?
Between Olomouc and Brno.
How many of you? How old were you when you were in Prostějov? I mean, how you didn't grow up in Prostějov the whole time.
I was born there because my grandmother lived there. My mother before the birth stayed with my grandmother for a little while, and we lived in Schönberg, and there I grew up.
Where is Schönberg?
It's up north, it's in the Sudeten.
Can you tell me what memories you have of Schönberg as a child?
A very uncomplicated childhood. Loving parents, comfort. My parents had a business and a big house, and they had people to look after me. They had a governess until I went to school full-time. Then I called her Miss, her name was Lydia Koba, and she looked after me, picked me up from school, and until I went to bed.
Dieter, what was your mother's and father's names?
My father's name was Rudolf, my mother's name was Ida.
And what did your father do? What business did he have?
He had the retail and wholesale clothing. The whole family, since grandfathers, were in the trade. And my other grandmother, my mother's mother, lived in Prostějov, but she came to live with us when she retired.
Can you remember the name of the business?
No.
Your house, you said it was a big, comfortable house. Can you describe it to me?
Well, it was a big, white villa with green lattices and climbing fruit trees. And the pretty garden, it was comfortable, and was grandma's there, and it was nice.
Did you have any brothers and sisters?
No, I was the only child.
How was that to be an only child in those days?
Well, I didn't know any other way, and my cousins lived across the road. They were a bit older, so I had a substitute.
How old were you when you started to go to school?
6.
What school did you go to?
Well, this was primary first, and then I went to the gymnasium, which was a private school, but I didn't stay very long because in 1938 we left.
In the primary school, how many Jewish children were there?
None. In Schönberg it was a very small town, and there were only 207 Jewish people living there. So there were very few Jewish children.
And what was your Jewish life at home like?
Well, we kept high holidays. My grandmother lit candles Shabbat. But I kept every half holiday because I didn't have to go to school. But that's about it.
Did you experience any anti-Semitism?
No. No, there was lots talked about it, but I was very young. I wouldn't have felt it, I wouldn't have understood it.
In the high school, did that change? Did you feel any anti-Semitism when you got a bit older?
No.
How did you identify as a Jew besides taking holidays, half holidays and things like that?
What do you mean?
Well, were you conscious of being Jewish?
Very much so.
In what ways? In what ways?
In every way. You associated only with Jewish people and you just felt very Jewish.
Can you remember the family discussing events in Europe from 33 onwards?
It was discussed, but it wasn't taken seriously enough. And I couldn't understand, now I can't understand, because my mother was on the 13th of March when the Germans took Vienna. She was in Vienna. And she saw what happened, that they didn't run then. I can't understand. My father was a soldier in the war, in the First World War, and he thought he would be protected whatever happened. And he didn't want to leave the comfort of his home, and my mother said, let's go to Palestine, let's go to America, maybe. And he said, here I'm a wealthy man, and in America I'll sweep streets. And it was discussed, but it wasn't... Nobody anticipated what's going to happen, what the future is going to bring.
So as a child growing up, what were your aspirations?
I wanted to become a doctor. I wanted to study medicine.
Were you a good student?
Yes.
What were your favorite subjects?
I liked math. I was pretty good in math. I loved school. And I was good at it, and I had some report cards here, and I did show it to my children, and they were not very impressed that I was an A-grade student.
Did you have any outside interests besides school?
Sport. I was swimming, which was very simple because it was sort of a little lake. One just went there, and it was great because there was an overhead railway bridge, and going for swimming you could stand on top and look down and count the wagons, and it was, in those days, it was quite something. And hiking and walking and going to meadows and pick flowers for a child were quite something, made like little bouquets. And in winter I was ice skating and skiing, because being such a small town I could put on my skis in the backyard and take off. Was easy, was simple, was great.
Did you belong to any organizations?
Not in Schoenberg. Later on, when there were more Jewish, where there was more Jewishness, and then it happened.
Did you go on holidays with your parents?
Yes.
Where did you go?
Karlsbad, Luhachowitz, Grevenberg, to Spas.
How was that?
It was fine. I wasn't that impressed. I just took it in my stride.
Can you tell me when life started to change for you?
Well, actually, it changed when we had to leave in September 38. Because my parents, the Sudeten were annexed, and my parents moved absolutely everything they possessed, and the shop and the store and the whatever there was, it was moved by truck to Prostjov. We fled 60 kilometers. And it was a hardship because the trucks went day and night because there was a lot to shift. We had three flats in one house my mother rented. There were storerooms rented. It was, for them, it was a mammoth operation. I was, of course, taken there with my grandmother, and parents were kind, loving, caring, and as long as I was in comfort, they didn't mind, they didn't complain. For me, it wasn't a big change because I was too young to understand. For them, it was horrendous.
Did they talk about that?
Yes.
Just to go back a little, what languages did you speak at home?
German. I couldn't speak Czech until I was 12 or 13. I learned it when I was 12. The first year was very strange, but children pick up fairly quickly.
So in Prostějov, did life resume its normal pace?
Well, it was normal because there was schooling, piano lessons. What I didn't like is that you had to be home at, there was curfew at 8 o'clock at night. Jews were not allowed on the street. And then you went to school and then there wasn't enough time sort of to have a good time. But for me it wasn't terribly hard.
How did that feel to have that curfew as a Jew?
Well, in those days, it was just an inconvenience, but it didn't grip me in any way. Well, I was too young to understand and to feel. I complained because I wanted to have a good time, but that was all. It didn't affect me any other way.
Did your level of identifying as a Jew change with that?
It changed altogether after we got to Prostějov because there were lots of Jews. There were 3,300 Jews living there. And there were youth groups. There were the Chelet Lavan, Maccabi Hatzair. I joined the Chelet Lavan and spent all my time there. And there were hiking of the weekend, camps. It was good.
Was there talk of leaving at any stage from Prostějov in those days?
There was a lot of talk, but nothing eventuated.
Which was the school you went to there?
It was a public school.
A mixed group, or Jews and non-Jews?
Few Jews, but very few that age.
And did you feel anti-Semitism there?
No. No. Not aware of it. I felt anti-Semitism when I came back. That's when I felt it.
After the war?
After the war.
Dieter, when Poland was invaded on the 1st of September, did anything change for you?
No, not really.
What impact did that have on an intellectual level in your household?
Well, my parents got very, very worried and very concerned and felt trapped. Because I don't remember exactly when my father was taking to sweeping streets, to cleaning snow. They felt very degraded.
In Prostějov that
in
happened?
In Prostějov, yes.
How did that happen? What was the...
You just got notified you have to be there and then at a certain time, and then you were just marched to sweep the streets.
Did your economic situation change?
No, because there was enough money there to last, because my parents sold off the stock of the shop, and there was plenty of money. No, there was no money, was never a problem. Wasn't discussed much either, because it was there. Yeah, food shortages, and you had to, but my mother was quite capable of providing. I mean, there was no shortage, there was nothing. Actually, you bought because it's war, you bought shoes, you bought clothes,
Were you at any stage told to wear a yellow star?
Yes, I don't remember the date, but yes.
And how did that impact on you?
Well, that's when you felt that you are different, that wasn't nice. That was bad.
Did you see any incidents of anti-Semitism during that time?
Well, our whole family was taken to the Gestapo once and interviewed for hours and hours on end. And we were let go, but I mean, you heard it, and people were locked up, and some were taken early to concentration camp. One of my uncles was taken much earlier than all the others. No, I mean, you knew. Yeah. My favor was my youth. That it didn't matter, my parents worried. I didn't worry that much.
When you said that one of your uncles was taken to concentration camp, what did you understand that was? Did you know what that meant?
I knew what it meant, but you have to see it to believe it. I knew it was some sort of a prison.
Can you tell me what happened gradually in Prostějov? You know, how life started to change and how things became more difficult?
Well, it became difficult when we knew that we had to leave. I mean, you left with a backpack.
And you
just walked out of whatever you owned. And on the backpack, not a lot of things you can take in a backpack. Just remember my mother having a light metal dish on the outside of the backpack. Couldn't understand why. Afterwards, when we were in Theresienstadt, I understood why, because that when she had a little bit of water, she could wash herself properly. But for them, it was horrendous. Absolutely horrendous.
How did you know you had to leave? What happened?
We were notified. I think by letter. You were notified and so and so, you have to be there and there. And we were taken to Olmütz, to a school where we spent the night, and the next day by train to Theresienstadt.
When was that?
30th of June. I have got even a number. I went with, I think, 360.
And where did you get? You gathered and then you were taken. How were you taken?
I mean, you marched to the train station. The school was not very far away from the train, and you walked and you were taken to Theresienstadt. But amazingly, very, very little was known about it. It was sort of, there was no mail coming for, you didn't know what you were in for. And I knew that Theresienstadt, or everybody knew that there are army barracks. But we were not accommodated in army barracks. It was a private house with a courtyard. It must have been a farm or something. And there we were accommodated. But for a youngster like me, you have got a blanket and you sleep on the floor. You sleep. You're tired. You sleep. But for older people, it wasn't as simple as that. My grandmother got a little bit of mattress to be on. I mean, the lady wasn't young anymore, and she never moved away from the mattress. That was sort of a comfort.
How many of you were together there
in the
house?
Room?
In the room?
A few hundred. I mean, it was cramped. But you could get out during the day. The gate locked at night. I don't remember what time, I think 8. But during the day you could get out of there. It was only a short period of time, so my father was somewhere else. My mother took it quite well. She was really with it, and she would have physically survived. My father never would have survived, because she just could not cope.
How did you get fed in that time? Where did?
I don't remember. I don't remember, but in Theresienstadt, I don't remember being hungry. So, I don't know. It's a long time ago, you know.
How long were you there?
Just for 2 months. While we were there, my uncle, my father's brother, died.
What was his name?
Dr. Karl Heilig.
What happened?
He had a heart attack. He had a heart condition, and it just didn't take it. And I remember out of the barracks on such a creaky cart, the coffin was taken, but you could go only to a little bit with him, and then he was taken alone. And my father, another uncle, was there, and his wife and his daughter. And then it came about that after 2 months that we have to leave. But when a close relative died, you were protected for a certain period of time, And it so happens that this time when our transport with R.G. was shifted out, my aunt and cousin were still protected, and they stayed in Theresienstadt, and they lived through the war in Theresienstadt, which was relatively speaking, easy.
How were you notified that you were going to be moved out of Theresienstadt?
No idea. My mother told me we are going, and that was it. And my grandmother stayed behind, and she was taken a little bit later to Auschwitz.
How do you know that?
My aunt that stayed there, she was in evidence, and she had a wonderful memory, and she didn't need to look up anything. She remembered thousands of people, but particularly being relations, so she knew that she went to Auschwitz.
Can you remember any more about Theresienstadt, the conditions, the environment there?
Not much, really. Firstly, we were there for a short period of time, and I wasn't organized in anything. We didn't do anything. There was nothing to do. Boredom was bad. Boredom was bad everywhere. But I somehow went and found some friends to chat to, walked, looked. It wasn't so regimented there yet.
How were the guards towards you?
Well, I had very little to do with them because being in this big private home, also there were a lot of people. I remember only when the gate shut at night. In the morning when it opened, one just went looking, and at night it was shut. No, I don't know much.
When you say went looking, within the confines of the...
Oh, yes, I mean, there was... you could go only from point A to B. No big roaming around. But friends were somewhere in another army barrack, so you just went and looked. It just wasn't so horrific compared to what's to come.
So, Dieter, what happened when they moved you out? How did they move you out?
Well, you did everything on foot. You went to the station, and we went by army train. We left. Normally, the normal... I think you went in cattle trucks, and we went by army train. The train was reasonably comfortable, but nobody ever knew where, what, and how. You went into the Blue Yonder, you just didn't know. And well, one looked out of the window and you saw this and there, you knew general directions. And the thing I remember most was Riga, when you stopped in for a day or so, and then we came to Raasiku in Estonia.
How long did that trip take?
5 days. We left on the 1st and we arrived there on the 5th. And
do you remember being given food on the train in that time?
And my mother had food along, some food. There was nothing given to us. She had some bottles with water, so no, I don't know. It wasn't supplied.
Do you remember what you took with you?
The rucksack went, backpack went, wherever we went. And actually, there was such a compartment where the luggage was, and that's where I sat and slept. But the train was not too bad, but there was no food given. None in the 5 days.
How many people went on that train?
1,500. A large amount. It's a long train. And we arrived in Raasiku. We unloaded, and there were quite a fleet of blue buses, very bright blue, and trucks. And people were walking towards the blue buses, and the luggage was taken by trucks, and I thought it was a good idea to stick to my parents, particularly to my mother, and I got onto the blue bus, and an S-man, and I know his name somewhere, I've written down, said, out, you're big and young, you go and work with the luggage. Well, so I said, see you later, and went to load up the luggage onto the trucks. And went with a truck to a camp. And my mother, my father, and most of the other people left in the blue buses. That's the last time I saw my parents alive. And when we got to the camp, there were army barracks. And we had to undress, and they looked if we have got anything of value, like watches, rings or so, was taken off us. By that time it was night, and we were shoot into the barrack. And then something very strange happened. You got in, you grabbed, not a bed, you grabbed a bunk or something. They were all sort of all in one. And then the next one came, and the next one came, and their support groups formed, families formed, because this was, you couldn't survive as a single, you didn't know, but somehow you wanted somebody, you wanted something to lean on. And friendships formed that night. And when I realized outside what was going on, I took off my watch and dug it into the ground. And thought, well, it's gone that way anyway, maybe I find it next day. The next day I found it, and I was a proud owner of the watch through the whole war, and just a few days before the war, somebody stole it from me. But I was a timekeeper, so that was it. And there we stayed for a while in this camp.
Can you tell me how many of you were put into a barrack?
I don't know how many there were in one barrack, but there were 100 of us.
Can you describe those barracks?
They were wooden barracks, very plain, with nothing else but just wooden planks.
And who were your guards there?
Estonian soldiers. They were sort of huts high, and we were guarded day and night. There was fencing. I mean, you couldn't get out. It was impossible. And on one side were women, about 100 women, on the other side were 100 men. They took from the transport, they took 200 people to work. And there we went and unpacked the luggage and sorted it into men, ladies, and underwear. And it was always taken away once it was sorted. So we were busy a while with this.
Well, what clothing were you allocated? What were you wearing?
Well, see, I still wore my own things. And as you were there and you wanted, you knew you wanted another jumper, you just took it. So their clothing was no problem. But then it got pretty cold, and we were shifted into a smaller house.
What time of the year was it? What date was it, do you remember?
It was already October, and in Estonia it gets pretty cold.
In what year?
So that was 42.
Okay, we'll stop here. We were taken to Theresienstadt. Were you in a type of camp?
Yes, there was a labor camp. We were planting trees.
Where was that?
That was not very far, I don't remember how far, but not very far from Prostyov. I don't even remember, I think we went there by buses. And we were housed in, I think there was some sort of wooden barracks, and it was tree planting. It was a special way of planting trees, first this, this, and this. It was hard labor.
Who went?
200 people from 200 young Jewish people. There were some much older than me, but except that we worked very hard, it was all right. There was food, and you had the bunk. And
did you get to go home at all, or were you?
No. We were there for 2 months, and after the 2 months.
Can you tell me when that was? What month and what year? Well, what year? Before Theresienstadt, obviously.
Before Theresienstadt, it was 42. It was
Do you remember the weather when you were?
It wasn't bad. It wasn't too cold. And anyhow, I never felt so cold anyway. In Prostyov, there were no extreme changes of weather.
When you were planting those trees, did they give you a reason why you were doing that?
Reforestation. And it was supposed to be something absolutely out of the ordinary because they wanted a certain type, a mixture of trees, so that's the only thing I remember.
And who were your guards then? Who?
Germans, German guards. But see, you had no intentions of running away anywhere because you only could have created a problem for yourself or for all the others. So you didn't entertain the thought to leave.
And what were your parents doing in Prostyov while you were in that camp?
Well, they didn't have very much to do. My father liked to play cards, so he got himself a card game, and my mother occupied herself in the household as well as she could.
Did that camp have a name?
No. No, I don't. If there was, I wouldn't remember.
Dieter, let's go back to Rasiku.
Yes.
And the labor camp there. Can you tell me the daily routine whilst you were there?
The daily routine, where are we? Still in the first one or we have moved already?
We're in Rasiku in the first one.
In the first one.
When you had clothes,
yes.
And...
The daily routine was that you got 3 slices of bread in the morning. That was one supposed to be for morning, lunch and dinner. And at night you got some sort of a soup. I have decided one slice of bread doesn't make me very happy. So I ate the 3 slices in the morning and didn't have to look after it. And once a day I was comfortable. And we did very hard work. We were felling trees. And we learned it, and we were told how, and we had a certain quota to get every day. It went to timber mills. In between, there were building huts and houses, we had to work there. But the felling tree to swing an axe and it was quite hard, and that's what was our occupation. So we were not... But see, it's a good thing, even if you had to work hard, as long as you had something to do, was terribly important, because to sit down and do nothing is a dreadful thing.
What were your feelings at that time?
See, you get... you don't feel much. It gets blunt. Not much of a feeling. There were dreams. I always dreamt, particularly in Estonia, I wanted to go back home, listen to the wireless, wear a black jumper and grey slacks. That was my dream.
So a particular black jumper and grey slacks?
No, and a box of chocolates and Edam cheese. That's what I dreamt about. I don't know, I didn't particularly like cheese, but I wanted an Edam cheese, and that was it.
And your camaraderie with that group that you formed at
first?
Oh,
that was very strong. That was very strong. You just looked after each other, and you tried to stay together and to work together, and you slept next to each other.
How many of you were there?
4. There were 3 young ones, a year or 2 maybe older than me, and there was one old lady. I think she was 42. In those days, you thought that maybe she was 43, you thought she was getting on. But she was very happy to be with us.
Do you remember their names?
Her name was Irma Glaser.
And the other girls?
Anke Kraus and Ilse Ettinger.
How old were you?
16.
Can I ask you a personal question?
Yes.
During that time, did you menstruate?
No. No, menstruation stopped. Just completely, for the whole time.
Did that concern you when all
no.
the others?
No, we were happy. I mean, hygiene was non-existing, or very little of it. I mean, that would be a disaster.
In those barracks in Rasiku, was there any illness amongst your group?
No, not nothing, no. We were still relatively in good condition. But from that barrack we moved in Rasiku into a house, which must have been office buildings there, because it was too big a place to guard just a handful of people. And getting quite cold, when we got into that private house, the days in Estonia are very short. And when the snow fell, the coloring was absolutely unbelievably beautiful. You had pinks and blues, very, very nice. And this house we were stationed at was on the river Jagala. And there we stayed until we went to Reval. It continued the same thing, only the working hours were much shorter. And I mean, you went to your bed or whatever you had, you went already 3-4 o'clock in the afternoon because there was no light.
So when you moved to the house, why did they move you there?
Because it was a much smaller complex and they needed fewer guards. The guards, they were towers, they were watchtowers, but such a small group needed less supervision.
So how many of you moved into that house?
Oh, we were 40, 50, not a great number.
And what happened to the other inmates of the camp?
They would have gone to Reval, to the prison.
So how long were you in that house?
Well, I don't remember exactly what time we went to Reval. We were there maybe a month or two months. I don't remember exactly, really.
Can you tell me when you went to Reval? What year?
I don't know if it was still 42 or 43. And then we went, and so we were housed in the prison, in proper prison cells. And we were working on the wharf, as wharf laborers, and we were taught how to lay bricks, how to build. And it was very hard. Hard labor. And actually there, people talked to us and offered quite frequently passage to away from there on the harbor by boat. But nobody believed that it would come off, and if one of us would have escaped, they would have shot 10 others for it. So you just didn't do that sort of a thing. And then the prison got so overcrowded that we got allocated offices there. There are a few rooms and we stayed there. So that was better than the prison routine that you, now when I hear on television the prison door slam, I said, that's how it was. That's how it was. You never forget.
How different were the sanitary and food and general conditions there to what you had before?
Well, see, it was relatively good, because in the prison cell we had one toilet and a basin. So you had something.
And how was the food?
Prison food. I mean, you got something in the morning and something at night. Not. Look, we were always hungry. We were hungry and cold.
When you said that if one of you would have escaped, the others, that would have risked others being shot.
Yes.
Did you ever see that happen?
No, but we knew, because messages came back on trucks, scribbled. One girl was taken, her name was Lily Penizek. And she was taken and she said, I'll be shot. Scribbled on the truck. So one didn't do that, because you could other lives into danger.
In that prison, what were the guards like there?
They were Estonian. Well, they didn't treat us different to any other prisoners. We were just treated as prisoners.
Dieter, during that time, did you think about your parents and where they were?
Oh, yes. We were wondering. See, when we arrived in Raasiku by train, we had lots of shots. But during the war, when you hear shots, it's a daily occurrence, but it didn't worry us much, of course. I mean, you're young, you're lonely, you miss your parents, you miss your family very much. And you keep wondering the whole time, where are they, how do they cope, how do they manage, avoid myself. My mother is okay, my father is not going to survive this, he can't cope with it. Yeah, very much so.
How did that sort of feeling affect you, in your activities there?
See, your feelings get very dull. You don't feel as strongly as you would feel normally, because this is life and you wonder if you're going to be around the next day and what is the next day going to bring, and you just take it as it comes. And then from the prison, we were taken again by train. You don't know the destination, and they were offloaded, I think, a couple of times in sort of camps under the stars. And from there they were taken to Goldfields, isn't it? I read the Goldfields. And there we stayed a long time, and that was pretty grim.
When was that? Do you remember what year that was?
I think it would have been already 43 by that time, I think.
How many of you were taken?
Well, it was a big transport, but 50 of us were taken with the others.
What sort of trains were they?
They were the cattle trains. And see, you doze, you sleep, some of the time you're not aware what's going on. But then we finally made, don't know how long it took and how long we were offloaded on certain camps. But the Rede Goldfield was very, very cold, but very close to Narva. And the temperature went down to 28 below. Not properly closed. Things are not good. And particularly they let us stand uphill in the morning for hours on end. And the cold just goes through you. There we had certain barracks, but there were lots and lots of us put onto a certain footage, and we couldn't lie down straight. We had to lie on the side to get sort of to lie down. And when we were so on one side, then all together had to change. That's a camp where they shaved our hair. To lose all your hair for a woman is quite a thing, but we decided it's not a good idea to lose the hair in front of everybody. We shaved our hair inside, and in the morning when it said, we shave your hair now, it was gone by that time. But it was a bad time. I was fortunate then when I got a job. I was working in the hardware store. And I said to my friend Ilse, I said, somebody who worked in the kitchen, I mean, they had it made. Said, nails, one can't eat nails. She was very smart. She said, just bring me a packet of nails. I had like riding breeches, so it was easy for me to bring the nails home. So I came with the nails, and she took off and came back with a loaf of bread. What did you do? She said, negotiate with the bootmaker. You give him, you bring nails and I get bread. So we were subsidized. So it was good. But in this camp, there were lice, lots of lice, and lice bring typhoid. So typhoid is, it's bad, temperatures are high. I got typhoid. I was unconscious for 2 weeks. I know absolutely nothing of 2 weeks of my life. I don't know if I ate, I don't know if I drank, I don't know if I was sick. Absolutely nothing. There was a barrack where all the sick people were. I mean, there was no protection because it was unfortunate. Some of them didn't get it. And in this period of time where I knew nothing, I think the most horrific thing that happened to me happened without my knowing it or just was being told. And then it didn't affect me that much. A baby was born, a boy. And they thought the child can't survive anyway, but maybe they can save the mother, and they drowned the child after birth.
Who drowned the child?
The doctor. And it didn't affect me then. Bad. Young, stupid, sick, didn't want me. But it got to me when my children were born. Because it was only few years after, and I did hold my precious thing in my arm. God, a few years ago, he wouldn't be alive. So, it was bad. Then what else was there? He was there for quite some time.
Dita, how is it that the woman that had the baby,
yeah.
How did she get pregnant?
Well, I don't know if she became pregnant there, but we were not segregated. I mean, there were men and women together, but maybe she arrived there pregnant. I don't know that.
Can you tell me the size of that camp at Erida? What the dimensions
were? It was fairly big. I don't know, thousands. It was a large camp, but a very large camp.
And what nationalities were there?
Polish, Germans, Czech. I forgot to tell you something before. When we arrived in Erida first, 2 weeks after, a second transport arrived from Berlin. So actually, there were always two transports. We were always together, mixed. The transport from Berlin had Czechs, mainly Germans, and Gypsies. But the Gypsies were never brought to mix with us. But in Erida there was, I think, mainly Polish, lots of Polish Jews. But big, very big.
And how did the different groups interact?
Well, quite well. I mean, you were in trouble, you were in camp, but our group always stayed together. We were like a family.
And those that weren't given jobs like yours, what was the main labor there?
I don't know what they did. They created, you know, sweeping the camp and doing this and doing that. There wasn't much doing.
So what did your job entail in the hardware store?
Stock taking, and when somebody needed this to... But it kept me busy and it kept me inside, where it wasn't that cold. But the cold was indescribable. Wasn't it 28 degrees? It wasn't always 28 degrees, but it was cold. Because 20 degrees is very cold too.
Dita, you said that a doctor looked out, drowned the baby.
Yes.
Where did the doctor, who was the doctor?
It was Jewish. It wasn't a German doctor.
And were there
It must have been in agreement with the mother because the baby wouldn't have survived.
In that time that you were in the hospital barrack, if you like, who cared for you?
There were sisters. I mean, amongst the prisoners, there were doctors, sisters, and there were people that, look, they knew what to do, but they didn't have, what do you do if you don't have medicine? But at least, I mean, when the fever was very high, they would believe they sponged me down, they cooled me down, water there was, what medications there was.
Was there much death?
Yes, people died. People died.
And do you know how they buried them? What happened?
Well, they just dug a hole and that was it, and particularly with the snow covering it. It was kept pretty separate, but there wasn't much water and there were no toilets, it was just dumps. It wasn't that good.
Dieter, were you aware at all of what was going on outside the camps?
No. No. We knew absolutely nothing. You didn't know if they were close, who is winning, you knew nothing. But it wasn't because you are dulled, your senses are dulled, it's not so bad. Today, if I don't hear news in the morning, I think something terrible because I must know what's going on. But those days, I didn't care particularly.
Within your barracks, did they form any, were there Jewish women who were given roles of authority to look after you by the Germans?
No, not really. We were sort of managing by ourselves.
So how long were you in Erida?
My notes say that.
Approximately.
I think a year, quite some time. From Erida we were taken to back to Reval and put on a ship and went to Danzig. And I don't remember how many days it took, but we arrived in Danzig and then we got to Stutthof.
How long were you on that ship?
Oh, could have been a week. It was quite a few days.
What sort of a ship was it?
I don't know. There was straw and you did lie down on the straw, or you got up on the straw, or you got seasick over the rail. I don't remember food, I don't remember. But we survived, we were sick.
How many of you were on that ship?
A few hundred. It was a big transport. It was a fairly big ship. And then I remember walking to Stutthof. I don't know how far it is. Never looked it up. Because I think I told you I'm an ostrich. I don't talk about camp. I don't read about camp. I don't watch about camp. When something comes on television, I just get up and off I am.
Why do you think that is?
I don't know. I somehow pulled the curtain and whatever happened is behind the curtain. I relift it, and I don't want it. And I even didn't, even my children don't, I never talk to. They don't know part of it. The only thing I did, my son was more interested in what went on, and he asked me more questions. My daughter didn't, but I thought she should know. And when I was in Israel, I took her to Yad Vashem, and it hit home. And I didn't like it there either, but I thought she just has to know. And as you know, Yad Vashem brings it out very well.
Let's stop here. I know it's... the 17th of November, 1995. Dieter, when did you arrive in Stutthof?
I think we left Erida in September.
What year?
43. Not 44? 44. And we were not there terribly long.
What did you see when you arrived there?
There you saw the proper card set, with the guards, with the wires, it was dirty, four people to a bank, sitting around during the day, doing absolutely nothing. The guards walked around with their rifle butts, they just hit people, just for the sake of hitting them without doing anything. No water, no food. That was a proper concentration camp. There it was really, really bad. And everybody had a little tag on the sleeve. You were tagged what you are. Jews had a little yellow triangle. And whoever did what, you could recognize what they did. And I was petrified of the green triangles because they were there because they murdered somebody. Now thinking back to be with a murderer, they were all murderers, so why worry about the green triangle? But that green triangle worried me no end.
How did you find out what the different tags meant?
Because people were there longer times and people talked because he did nothing else but sit around and the days were very, very long because there was nothing to do. So that was, I mean, a day seems like a month. And that was a proper concentration camp routine. Pushed, shoved, chased, fear. There was fear there.
Well, what was the food like there?
We were hungry. Hungry, we were all the time.
And what about acts of violence towards you? Did you ever experience that?
Yes, I was hit with a rifle butt, and there was for a few days I was deaf completely, but nobody escaped that. I mean, you didn't have to do anything. They were sadists.
Who were the guards there?
Germans. German guards. From now on, it's only German, really.
So what did you wear on your sleeve?
Yellow.
And what did that mean?
Jew.
And what, can you tell me some of the other, murderer and Jew, and what else was there?
I don't know, there were political ones, there were red triangles, I don't remember anymore, but by color code you knew why you were there. But we were not there terribly long, which was good. We went from there to, by train, to Hamburg, Hamburg-Ochsenzollern. They had a munition factory there, the Hanseatische Kettenwerke, and they needed laborers. And they had two or three barracks there, and there we were housed. Everybody had a bed with a straw in it, and you had somewhere to sleep. You were taken to the Hanseatische Kettenwerke. You worked for 12 hours. It was hard labor.
Birds.
it was hard physical labor, but there was a certain routine to your life. The day shift was all right. You worked from, I think, from 6 to 6. Because you got home, you got a plate of soup, and you went to bed and you could sleep. The other day, when you had night shift, was very bad. Because during the day, there were constant inspections. Achtung! You had to hop out of your bed and then the sleep was constantly broken. But the people that ran the munition factory were interested that we get reasonable treatment. Because if you're tired and not strong, you don't work very hard. So we were sort of reasonably well looked after. And there were wash basins you could wash and you got a plate of soup at night, and you got a plate of soup in the morning. And there was a routine in your life. It wasn't wonderful, but it's, and there were lots of air raids, because this was the end of the war, and you could see the planes, you could hear the planes, you could see the planes shot down. Sometimes we were taken to the air raid shelter, but it wasn't it.
What was your job there? What did you do?
First I started some screws on the machine, did some screws, but then I was picked out to work in the office, which was easy work relatively. I mean, you worked for 12 hours, but it wasn't that physical demand to stand on your feet for 12 hours.
Why do you think you were picked out?
I don't know. I think because I'm big and strong. And always was big and strong. Then I was picked out. The chap's name was, that picked me, that ran the office, his name was Blau, I remember. And he was quite decent. He told me what to do, and he taught me, because I'd never worked in an office before. So the day shift was very busy, the night shift wasn't busy. It dragged on. But still, it was relatively speaking, it wasn't too bad, because I'm a great one for sort of discipline and timing and organizing. So that wasn't too bad. But that was Hamburg Ochsenzoll.
Just to go back a little, when you left Stutthof, how did they make the selection to go to Hamburg?
Well, you were called up. A certain whole group, a whole barrack was marched to the train and they were taken.
When you say train, what's
it? Cattle train. The normal mode of travel.
And you were stayed with your group of
always
original group?
Yes.
How long were you there, do you remember, in Hamburg Ochsenzoll?
Hamburg Ochsenzoll was a few months until I was taken to Bergen-Belsen. And Bergen-Belsen was a real nightmare. I hadn't seen many dead people before, but there when we got there, they were stacked like logs. Four. It was all covered up, so, but when the wind blew, you could see. I mean, I don't know, miles, kilometers, hundreds of meters, but there were corpses. And the smell of Bergen-Belsen is something unforgettable. The smell, the stench of Bergen-Belsen. And there was, and it was muddy, it was dirty. And four to a bunk. And you couldn't get out. You were there for 24 hours a day. There was nothing to do, nowhere to go. And if you would have wanted to go, you would have bumped into corpses, rotting corpses. I mean, it was absolutely an unbelievable period. Undescribable what Bergen-Belsen was. And no food, and some soups, there was all this. And after a couple of months, I was called out. Don't know if by name or by number, but I was called out. And I said, well, that's it. That's it. And they told me, you have to go back to Hamburg. I said, why? You have been requested. WW, wirtschaftlich wichtig. I didn't know how important I was, but I was requested. I somehow think this fellow that employed me pulled some strings because he must have known.
This is Blau.
Mr. Blau.
Blau, yeah.
I think so. He never admitted it when I tackled him, but I think it was him. And a group of us, not many, 12 or so, and we were supposed to be taken by train back to Hamburg. But when we got to the station, it was burning because the night before it was bombed. So we walked by night, and by day we were lying down in the other rail and slept a bit. I don't know how we walked, but we walked to Hamburg because we went to the next station and it was burnt out, and when the stations are fairly close, 2-3 kilometers, not very far. And we made that camp. We got back on foot, God knows how, only God knows how.
Did you have guards with you?
Yes. They walked with us. They were more scared than us. And when we got back to Hamburg, only the group of us was there, so why we had to come back, why we had to work, me in the office, not much to manage there because there was hardly anybody there. And we worked. And that was already, I think that was already April 45. And then Mr. Brahman asked him what's going on, and said, ah, the war won't last long. And then he was rather talkative. And well, then we knew something is happening.
How many of you went to from Bergen-Belsen on that walk?
Not many. It might have been 14, 16. Not a great deal.
How long did it take you to walk that?
Days. Days.
And how did you get fed on that trip?
Don't know. But we were not in good condition, so whatever mileage we did, it's an absolute miracle that we made it. And then in Hamburg, Ochsenzoll, after, I think we were there about 3 weeks, we were loaded up on trains again. Oh, back to Bergen, where is it now, what is it now? And it took us, and I don't remember the station, because by that time I really didn't care anymore. I had enough of the lot. We were taken out from the cattle trains, and there was another train standing there, and there were people running around in white coat, and sisters were running around, and we were ushered into a normal train. Couldn't understand why. They were given some food, something to drink, and the people in white coats were very aggressive towards the Germans. We had no idea what it was. None. And after a while we took off with the train and we arrived in Copenhagen.
This was the 16 people from
Hamburg. A small group. In the train there were others, so they had brought from other camps people. And we still were not aware what was going on. And in Copenhagen, people came. Food, trays of cakes, sausages wound around. They just threw food into the train. Still didn't realize what was happening. I didn't eat, I didn't fancy eating, I didn't want anything. And people who ate got very, very ill. And the train went onto the boat ferry. And they were told they were being taken to Sweden, in Copenhagen. And we were allowed out of the train and we found that ship was nice, we found lounges like this, and we lie down and in comfort and we slept until somebody woke up and didn't hear any noises, and we decided we'll go out and look. It was dark by then, and there were some men running very excitedly in front of the ship, and there was a Czech consul. They couldn't believe that there were no Czechs on the boat. But we slept. We didn't get off the boat with the others, so we got off later. And they welcomed us. It was the 4th of May, it was my birthday. And there were tents there. They sprayed us, they showered us, they deloused us, they gave us some clothes. And we were taken to King Gustav's stadium in Malmö. The old king liked to play tennis. He liked to play winter and summer. So we were taken there, and there were sort of beds prepared and bedside tables and doctors and nurses, and we had medicals, and I was in relatively good shape, but they brought some people in on stretchers. I mean, tall men weighing 42 kilos, 41 kilos, 38 kilos. They were just bones, heaps of bones. And there's the nurses, there's the, they really looked.
How much did you weigh, do you know?
I'm ashamed to say. 63 kilos. They put me on the scale and looked, and I went away, and they called me back because they thought it was a malfunction of the scale. I'm very heavily boned, but I was the heaviest inmate. And
well, why do you think that was?
I don't know. A camp doctor once said to me, "Do you come from a very wealthy home?" The third year, why? He said, "You must have been very well fed as a child." So I'm a firm believer that to feed children well, so after my experience. And in Malmö we stayed not terribly long because they had a set up there for people to come. Why did we get to Malmö? Count Bernadotte came to Germany, I think it was already in 45, I don't think it was 44, and he wanted to exchange prisoners of war. And he came to camps where prisoners of war were, and the camps were spruced up, they were cleaned up, they were tidied up for him to come. But he didn't like what he saw, so he said he doesn't exchange prisoners of war, he takes whatever or whoever they give and to exchange prisoner. That's how they started to empty the camp already before the war actually ended. But they were set up in that tennis stadium, and they left us, and every township in Sweden took on a group of people to nurse, to look after.
How did you know, when did you find out about Count Bernadotte?
There in Sweden, when we arrived, that it came through Bernadotte. And we were allocated to Värnamo, a small township. They made the scout hall operational. And that's where we ate and slept, where there was a 24-hour nurse in attendance. And the township took upon themselves to nurse us back to health.
How many of you were there?
About 28. And when we were well enough, they got us jobs that we could earn some money. And
how long were you there?
I came back only in November 45 to Czechoslovakia, so 6 months.
During that time, were you concerned about the rest of your family and what happened to them?
Well, lists came out. Lists came out, you were always wondering, you were hoping. And as the lists came from people that died, there were lists already that died in various concentration camps, and there were people that survived in Theresienstadt. And of course we all went and checked and checked, and we couldn't find anything, but not one of us that I was a survivor. We couldn't understand it, we just could not understand it. And we were invited in Värnamo, every group sort of honored us and welcomed us, and some invited us for breakfast, some invited us for brunch. And one religious group invited us for supper. Excuse me. And it was very nice, it was very pleasant. And they had a buffet. And people, having been hungry for a long while, rushed to the buffet and wanted to eat. And we stayed behind, three of us, my little group. And we thought, well, you're not hungry, there'll be plenty of food left. It's all right. And the priest approached us. And the usual questions, have you found family? How long have you been? Where have you been? And we told him, I've been in Estonia. And there is not one of us as a survivor. We don't know why, how, and what happened to them. And the man got so pale, the man got so changed color, and he said, and what date was it? The 5th of September. And what was the township Rasik? And he changed so much, he was besides himself. And they said, you know, and they said, I do. I mean, that happened in Rälsike when we were in Sweden, in a small township. And they said, look, I'm a priest, and you cannot give away what you are being told in confession. But under those circumstances, I feel free to speak. And he spoke. When we arrived in Värnamo, the blue buses were taken across the river to a hill, Kalia. And the graves were dug. People had to undress naked. They had to lie in the grave. They shot them in the graves. The next ones that were alive had to lie on the dead ones and were shot until they were rid of all the people. Not even the clothes, they had to be degraded like this to be naked. And to lie on a corpse, to be shot there, they're horrific, horrific thing. And the same thing happened 2 weeks after, when the German transport came. And mainly the gypsies, they shot them all, they didn't give any of them a chance. And after the war, I mean, he wrote it down actually, so, and he gave me the names of the Sturmbannführer, and one of them escaped to America, and when they chased him, he knew he's going to be caught, he hung himself. This information is 20 years old. One of them worked in England in a textile factory, but most of the detailed information came from the VIP driver who drove them. And there are quite a few names there.
Do you know those names?
Yes.
Do you want to tell me?
I don't know them by heart. Okay. I can give it to you later. I can give you the name of the people, the SS, and can give you the name of the witnesses. And after we found out what actually happened, one of the girls, her name was Gitta Kleinerova, followed it up. She had an acquaintance in Estonia, and she found out exactly where it was, and one fellow that was doing the shooting escaped to Russia, but he was in prison. But then the Russian people on top of the mountains put down 2 plaques in memory of the 2 transports. And they went there, 6 of them, and they visited. And so we found out through a coincidence, sitting and waiting for food with a priest.
Do you remember his name?
No. I had a letter from him, and I haven't got it anymore. I should be more careful.
Dieter, how did you feel when he told you that story?
Terrible. I still don't. You don't forget. Right.
How did you decide to go back to, and how and why did you decide to go back to Czechoslovakia?
Well, there was nowhere else to go. My aunt, that's a wife, Theresienstadt, my cousin, took me in.
How did you find out about their survival?
On a list that came.
And did you correspond with them from Sweden? What happened?
I had written to them. Those lists must have been worldwide. Because a cousin of my mother's, where I've got a photograph too, he wrote to me. He lived in America. But to me it was, I mean, it was the only relative of this very large family that survived. And she was very kind to me.
What was her name?
Rosa Heilig. And her daughter survived with her in Theresienstadt.
And her name?
And her son, Erika. Erika Aufricht now. And her son lives in Sydney. So,
Well, what was it like going back to Prostchov?
It was very grim, really, because here lived my mother, here lived my uncle, here lived my aunt, and nobody was there. It was a Kailav of 3,000, 306,000 people, and there were 33 Jews there. We're very 1%, isn't it? Everybody had gone. But what I forgot to say before, I learned dressmaking when I got the Prostchov from Schönberg. So I had to get myself a profession, so I got myself a sort of a diploma that I can work as a dressmaker and earn a living.
How old were you then?
I was 19 when I got back.
How did you get back? What?
By train. We came from Sweden to Lübeck, so Germany, and to Prague. In Prague we got 500 crowns and I just had a little suitcase. But my mother had friends, Czech friends, before we went to Theresienstadt, and she gave some things for keepsake, to keep when we come back, that it should be there. So I went to people, some returned and some didn't. But the most precious thing, and the thing that surprised me most, was that I got a prayer book back of my mother, because that was very dangerous to keep. But I got clothes and bed linen and my parents had property, and so that had to be put into my name. One was busy and I worked, so, and I met my husband there, so he was one of the 33.
How did you meet him through?
Well, see, you met at people's places. One Friday it was here, and one Friday it was there, and one just, we just stuck together. It was sort of, I mean, I had family, I had an aunt and a cousin, but some of them had nobody, so it was, you met.
What happened when you met?
When we met, well, we talked, and memories and so, and it's...
You said in the beginning that you didn't feel anti-Semitism until after the war. What did you feel when you went back?
Well, quite a lot of Czech people did show they were anti-Semites. They said, how come that you fell through the grill? And it hurt.
Did you respond to that?
No. No. See, particularly what my mother did to give people to mind things. Others did too. And if somebody returned, they had to give some of it back. And those that didn't return, they could keep it all in good conscience. I never went back. Only 3 years ago was the first time that I went back to Czechoslovakia, because I know I'm not quite right. I feel when in 1938 they yelled Heil Hitler, they welcomed the Germans, and then when the Russian came, they yelled Zdrastuite. They are in an unfortunate geographical position, but somehow I don't particularly like it. The nature is beautiful, absolutely lovely, but that's it.
Stopping. Dieter, did you marry Ernest?
Yes, I did, on 21st of October, 47. And the communists came shortly after, and my husband has a sister in Sydney, and he wanted to leave, he just didn't want to stay.
Can you describe your wedding to me before we go?
It was a very It was a simple ceremony. It was just my husband and I. A cousin of mine was my witness, and his twin brother was his witness. Nothing else. And my aunt, we didn't want anybody, but my aunt was there. She was standing behind me and crying the whole time. And we went on honeymoon and came back, and that was it. Nothing.
Where did you go on a honeymoon?
I forgot the name of it. It was a beautiful hotel in the Beskiden. Virginia. It was very nice.
Was it a difficult decision to leave Czechoslovakia?
Not at all. Not at all. There was nothing to keep me there. Absolutely nothing.
How did your aunt feel about you going?
Well, she was very much in favor. She was very much in favor of me to go. She moved, we lived together in Prostějov. She moved then in with her daughter in Orlova near Ostrava. And she liquidated the whole flat. No, she was, it was the only thing to do, and we left and never regretted it.
How difficult was it to leave?
Very, very. You couldn't get a piece of paper of anybody without bribing. And whenever our papers in Czechoslovakia seemed in order, our permit had expired. So it was, it cost us a fortune. Because it didn't matter, because all we wanted was to get out. My husband was of military age. It was hard to get taxation, and they made it as difficult as possible. And anyhow, in those days, it took a long, long while to go. We were, came with Ugolino Vivaldi, and we were on the boat over 7 weeks. It wasn't a very flashy transport, but anyhow, it didn't matter. Only the funny part about it was, whenever I was on a boat, whenever, on the small river, I was always seasick. Well, I thought, well, 7 weeks I have to be in bed, can't be helped. I want to go to Australia, that's the price I pay. Got onto the ship. I wasn't seasick once. My mother-in-law and I were the only passengers in the dining room. Not it was worthwhile eating, but we kept going. I wasn't seasick once. That's funny.
Who were your fellow passengers?
All migrants. We were in the so-called cabins, and the hull of the ship that were Italians, but all migrants.
Were there other Jews on the ship?
Oh yes, mainly Jewish. Mainly Jewish.
When was that?
I think we left in 48 and arrived here in 49.
When?
December 48 we left Czechoslovakia and arrived, I think, on the 28th of February. We stayed a few days in Vienna and arrived on the 28th of February. Yeah.
What was your first impressions of Australia?
Very strange. A different world. Loved it. We loved it. It was very hard because we came with a lift, with furniture, but we had no money. But jobs were plentiful, so we worked pretty hard and built up a clothing business here. And had the children, lived happily ever after.
Tell me, Dieter, you said that you never told your story.
No.
And now you've decided to do it. Can you tell me why?
Well, I never told my children very much about it. I felt if I do, that I might burden them with something. My son read up a lot. My daughter, as I said, I took her to Yad Vashem. As my children don't know a great deal, my grandchildren would know nothing. So if they wish so, do so. My husband was a driving influence, and my daughter-in-law actually said yes, and for the children, and it should never be forgotten, it should never happen again, and it's important. And between the two of them, they got me to do it.
Your experiences, do you think it's affected your feeling towards being Jewish?
This feeling gets much stronger. You feel, well, with me, I mean, I always was brought up in a Jewish environment, but this makes you much more so towards Jewish and towards Israel, of course. Very strong feeling for Israel.
Before we get to the very end, is there anything that you would like to say, or any incidences that you perhaps would like to recall that you haven't talked about?
No, not really. If there would be something, I have forgotten it. No, there's nothing special.
So in that case, I'll ask you, with your experiences in those years, and with the 50 years that have passed since they were over, do you have any message for future generations, your own future generations?
Do everything in moderation.
Why do you say that?
Because every extreme is bad. Every extreme. That's my philosophy, so right or wrong.
Dieter, thank you.
Pleasure.
Who's the lady in the photograph?
This is my grandmother.
Her name?
Amalia Heilig.
And
my grandfather, and Jacob.
And where was the...
That was in Schoenberg, Marie Schoenberg, taken.
Do you know when?
About 1900.
Do you have memory of them at all?
No, they died before I was born. They had 6 sons and 1 daughter.
And your father was one of the sons?
My father was one of the sons, yes. My father's name was Rudolf.
How many survived the war?
None. They all perished in the war.
This picture, Dieter?
This is my father's only sister, my aunt Rosa Hacek.
Where was it taken?
In Schoenberg. She was a young woman then.
Do you know what year it was taken?
Oh, I would say 1910, 1915.
This picture?
This are my cousins, the children of my aunt Rosa, which we have seen just before.
On the left?
On the left is Alice, and on the right is Kurt.
Where was it taken?
I would say late 20s.
And where?
In Boskovitz.
Do you know where they perished as well? Yeah?
Yes.
Do you know where they perished?
I have got the concentration camp. That's on the family tree things. Yes.
Can you describe this photo?
This is the high school I went to, a private school in Schoenberg, just before the war.
That's the building on the right?
Yes, a big building. It's still standing. I've been and seen it.
Who's in this picture, Dieter?
That's my first school photo. This is me and my teacher. I never knew that he's Jewish, but I met him in Theresienstadt.
Do you remember his name?
Professor Kraus.
Where was this picture taken?
At school.
Where, in which school?
In the private school, in Schoenberg.
And what year was it?
38.
This picture?
This picture is Schoenberg, that I grew up.
And that's how you remember it?
That's how I remember it, and that's how it still is. A very nice, quiet, pretty place.
This picture?
This is Prostio of the town hall, and that hasn't changed either. That's exactly the same as it used to be.
It survived the war? It wasn't bombed or anything?
No.
When was this picture taken?
In 38. It was a class photo.
Where was it?
In Prostjov, in the high school.
And can you find yourself?
That is me, and that's my friend Leah, that lives in Israel.
How did you get these photos?
They were kept by friends, what my mother sort of handed out and was given to me then.
Where was this photo taken?
This photo is taken in Marienbad. My father is a gentleman on the right, rather portly. The man next to him is Mr. Schoenberg.
And the other one?
I don't remember his name.
And what year was it taken?
34.
This photo?
This is a wedding photo of my mother and father on the 1st of March 1925.
Where was it taken?
In Prostyov.
This photo?
This is my mother, taken in about 39 or 40 in Prostyov.
In your backyard?
No, I think that was on Hagibor.
Who's in this photograph?
This is my grandmother's sister.
What's her name?
Louise Hübsch. Next to her is my mother. Next one is me. And this is my grandmother. We met in a spa in Luhačovice in 34, I think it was. Could be 36, I'm not sure.
And your grandmother's name on the left?
Betty Schwedt.
This photo?
This photo is the three survivors. It was taken in 38 or 39, but the three of us survived. That's my cousin Erika Aufrecht, my cousin Robert Heilig, and me.
They're the only three cousins to
survive? The whole family, yeah.
Where was it taken?
In Prostyov.
When?
I would say 38 or 39, shortly after we arrived there.
This photograph?
This is my father and me in 38.
Where was it taken?
It was taken in Prostyov, just in front of, on the balcony in front of our flat we had there.
Can you describe this armband, Dieter?
This is the only thing I have from concentration camp, which is an armband which I wore, which marks the Hanseatischen Kettenwerke Hall 4.
What does that mean?
That's where I belonged, where I worked.
Which camp was that?
Hamburg-Ochsenzoll.
What's the story behind these scissors, Dieter?
This was a present I was given when I arrived in Sweden on the 4th of May, when I was liberated. One of the girls, that was the only thing she possessed, and she gave it to me as a birthday present because I arrived on my birthday.
Which girl gave it to you?
Hilda was her name. Don't remember her second name.
Can you describe this photograph?
This is on the 9th of May in the tennis stadium in Malmö. I've been 5 days there already, nursed and looked after, and that is me.
And are your friends there that survived the camp with you?
Yes, and this is the girl that gave me the scissors.
And the two other girls that went through the camps?
This one.
Her name?
Anka Kurs.
And the other one?
The other one is Ilse Ettinger, isn't there. But I went all with them. I know most of the names, but I don't have contact with them. She's the only one I've got contact with.
This photograph?
This is the Lord Mayor of Värnamo.
On the right?
On the right.
Do you remember his name?
No. Eklund, I think. That's his wife, and this is his sister that was in charge of us.
So where was this taken?
In Värnamo in 45.
This photograph?
This is our wedding photo.
Taken on?
21st of October 47.
In?
Prostyov.
And this photograph, Dieter?
This is my aunt that took me in after the war, and she was very kind to me, and she was a very big influence.
And her name?
In my life, Rosa Heilig.
And where was it taken?
That was taken in Germany. They moved from Czechoslovakia to Germany eventually.
And what year was it taken?
Oh, it would be about 88.
Can you tell us about this book, Dieter?
This was my mother's prayer book. She always took it to synagogue.
And you got it?
It must have been kept somewhere by a friend of hers, and it was given to me after the war. It's only in German. It's very old. It was printed, I think, in 1850.
Okay. This photograph?
This is my son Ron with his son Dan, Benny. It's taken only because he mightn't be able to come.
And it's taken in Sydney?
That has been taken in Sydney in a park.
What year?
Last year, that would be...
94? 94. Right. Dieter, would you like to introduce this wonderful group?
Yes, I would. My husband, Ernest. My son, Ron. My daughter, Judy. My daughter-in-law, Christine. And my wonderful grandsons, Benjamin and Matthew. Hello.
Ron, would you like to say a few words to your mum, please?
Hi, Mum. This is a very traumatic thing for my mother to do, because my mother has never spoken about the Holocaust at all. In fact, whenever any war movies came on TV, Mum would leave the room. So it was not spoken about at all, only bits and pieces from my father. The only time I suppose they actually spoke about in any detail was I stood in a pre-selection for the Labor Party a number of years ago, and my political opponents urged the Labor Party pre-selection voters to vote for a Catholic rather than the Jew boy from Botany, and although it caused some consternation. And it was probably after that time when I spoke to my parents about it that my father started talking a bit more about the Holocaust. It certainly gave me a very great political appreciation of the fact that we still have a society, even in Australia, that comprises of people who are anti-Semitic. And what I think you're doing is very important, because there's one message, a very old saying, that those who forget history are bound to relive it. And it is very important that people not only in this country but throughout the world never forget the Holocaust.
I would agree with that. And I can tell you that your mother did a wonderful job and has a very important story to tell. And I want to thank her for being wonderful and for giving us her time. And thank you all for coming this afternoon. It's been great. Thank you.